Blessed be the one, holy and living God.
Glory to God forever and ever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and merciful God, it is only by your gift that your faithful people offer you true and laudable service. Grant that we may run without stumbling to obtain your heavenly promises. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Deuteronomy. Now, these are the commandments, the regulations, and the case laws that the Lord your God commanded me to teach you to follow in the land you are entering to possess, so that you will fear the Lord your God by keeping all his regulations and his commandments that I am commanding you, both you and your sons and daughters, all the days of your life, and so that you will lengthen your life. Listen to them, Israel. Follow them carefully so that things will go well for you and so that you will continue to multiply exactly as the Lord, your ancestors' God, promised you in a land full of milk and honey. Israel, listen. Our God is the Lord, only the Lord. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your being, and all your strength. These words that I am commanding you today must always be on your minds. Recite them to your children. Talk about them when you are sitting around your house and when you are out and about, when you are lying down and when you are getting up. Tie them on your hand as a sign. They should be on your forehead as a symbol. Write them on your house's door frames and on your city's gates. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm today is Psalm 119, verses 1 through 8. Let's read it responsibly by half verse. Happy are they whose way is blameless,
who walk in the law of the Lord.
Happy are they who observe his decrees,
and seek him with all their hearts.
Who never do any wrong,
but always do.
You laid down your commandments,
that we should fully keep them.
Oh, that my ways were made so direct,
that I might keep your statutes.
Then I should not be put to shame. I will thank you with an unfeigned heart. I will keep your statutes.
Do not let me forsake.
A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. But Christ has appeared as the high priest of the good things that have happened. He passed through the greater and more perfect meeting tent, which isn't made by human hands. That is, it's not part of this world. He entered the holies of holies once for all by his blood, by his own blood, not by the blood of goats or calves, securing our deliverance for all time. If the blood of goats and bulls and the sprinkled ashes of cows made spiritually contaminated people holy and clean, how much more will the blood of Jesus wash our consciences clean from dead works in order to serve the living God? He offered himself to God through the eternal Spirit as a sacrifice without any flaw. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
One of the legal experts heard their dispute and saw how well Jesus answered them. He came over and asked him which commandment is the most important of all. Jesus replied, "The most important one is, 'Israel, listen. Our God is the one Lord, and you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your being, with all your mind, and with all your strength.' The second is this, 'You will love your neighbor as yourself. No other commandment is greater than these.' The legal expert said to him, 'Well said, teacher, you have truthfully said that God is one and there is no other besides him. And to love God with all of the heart, a full understanding, and all of one's strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself is much more important, excuse me, than all kinds of entirely burned offerings and sacrifices.' When Jesus saw that he had answered with wisdom, he said to him, 'You aren't far from God's kingdom.' After that, no one dared to ask him any more questions." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
President Biden met with Pope Francis this past week. As reported by the Associated Press, the world's two most prominent Roman Catholics ran over time in their discussion on climate change, poverty, in the coronavirus pandemic, a warm conversation that also touched on the loss of the president's adult son and included jokes about aging well. But what was the lead for the article was something quite different. Quote, "Biden, Pope told me I should keep receiving communion." Their conversation, which reportedly ran 75 minutes, was private, with a Vatican spokesman refusing comment. But President Biden told reporters, "We just talked about the fact that Pope Francis was happy I was a good Catholic and I should keep receiving communion." You may recall that for a number of years, prominent American conservative Catholic bishops have told priests in their dioceses not to give communion to Biden should he appear in their parishes because of his support for abortion rights, including Denver's former Archbishop Charles Chaput. Indeed, if you lived in Denver in 2004, you may remember that he urged local clergy to deny communion to John Kerry, also a Catholic, when he came through town in his bid for the presidency. Chaput's assertions in 2004 prompted the Vatican's Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith to concur that holding any positions contrary to church teaching might result in the denial of communion. In another news item, on a somewhat different topic, although still on issues of sexuality, we learned this week that the House of Bishops of the Anglican Church in Ghana has endorsed the passage of a proposed law that would subject anyone who self-describes as LGBTQ to a prison term of up to 5 years. In a statement released by the Ghanaian bishops, "The support of the church for the anti-LGBTQI bill is born out of the belief that the practice is unbiblical and ungodly. We see LGBTQI as unrighteousness in the sight of God, and therefore will do anything within our powers and mandate to ensure that the bill comes into fruition." That statement has, not surprisingly, met with opposition from other Anglican bishops. And while not a recent news item, some while back, I sat down with a couple of seekers. These two folks were interested in the Episcopal Church, especially its liturgy and attractive architecture, and had attended several, but were concerned about a somewhat perceivable lack of theological squishiness, my term, not theirs. They had heard that there wasn't a lot of emphasis in the Episcopal Church put on the exact definition of the doctrines of the virgin birth, on bodily resurrection, on the authority of Scripture. I learned later in the conversation that they came from the Christian Reformed tradition, a branch of Calvinism that does, in many ways, stress doctrinal orthodoxy and uniformity. It was a very cordial conversation, but while I had my hopes that the Episcopal Church's breadth might be attractive to them, I fear it did not. Stories and encounters like these have for years reminded me of the kinds of questions put to Jesus, such as this morning's query from the scribe, which commandment is the most important of all? A similar question is raised earlier in Mark, not by a religious scholar, but rather a wealthy man. Good teacher, what must I do to obtain eternal life? Indeed, between these two questions, between the question by the wealthy man and the scribe, are three more questioners who ask much the same thing. At the end of Mark 11, priests, as well as others, want to know the source of Jesus' authority, that is, wondering if his teaching would lead to salvation. Pharisees and Herodians want to know if salvation has anything to do with obeying secular rulers, specifically in the area of paying taxes. And of course, immediately before our reading this morning, the Sadducees want to situate Jesus in the debate between the Pharisees and the Sadducees' interpretations of the law, using the question of the resurrection as the focal point. In all of his answers, Jesus refuses to enter into the debate in the way the questioners desire. The same questions are a point of discussion in the book of Acts, as the gospel message spreads beyond the boundaries of Judaism into the Gentile world. The heart of the matter then is how much of the Jewish law are Gentiles bound to keep? Circumcision, kosher, etc. And the answer given at the so-called Jerusalem Council is, it has seemed good to the Holy Spirit and to us to impose on you no further burden than these essentials, that you abstain from what has been sacrificed to idols and from blood and from what is strangled and from fornication. If you keep yourselves from these, you will do well. Even the answer given by the Jerusalem Council doesn't entirely enter into the seething debate about conformity to Jewish law. Instead, it points in a different direction. That is, cease living like your pagan neighbors. The desire to know exactly what is necessary to do to be saved, or which commandment is the most important, permeates the Hebrew Bible as well. It lies at the root of the Israelites' struggle to understand much of its own history. Why have we been overrun by the Philistines? Why was the northern kingdom destroyed by the Assyrians? Why was Jerusalem sacked and our leaders taken into exile into Babylon? Several answers often seem to have been given. One answer was that they were not being faithful to the religious aspects of their covenant with God, that they were intermarrying and turning to the worship of Baals. The 8th century prophets like Isaiah, Micah, and Hosea took this a step further and pointed to the many injustices in their societies and the mistreatment of the marginalized. These questions are reflected in the passage we heard Jesus quote from Deuteronomy. Listen to these commands, Israel. Follow them carefully so that things will go well for you and so that you will continue to multiply exactly as the Lord your ancestors God promised you in a land full of milk and honey. Listen, Israel, our God is the Lord, only the Lord. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your being, and all your strength. These words that I am commanding you today must always be on your minds. And the questions are central to all of Psalm 119. Happy are they whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. I suppose you could argue that the question of salvation is at the heart of the scriptures. And of course it is, I suppose, the central concern of Jesus. The difference, however, in many of the other answers to the questions is there seemed to be a concern about techniques or precision. Did we perform the sacrifices correctly or in the right place? What must I do to be saved? Will paying taxes to Caesar compromise my salvation? Must Gentile converts be circumcised? Or more recently, must we believe in a literal virgin birth? Or is only one expression of sexuality allowable in the realm of God? As I noted earlier, Jesus, in all of the questions that were put to him in Mark, refuses to be drawn into such debates. Instead, he points to the bedrock of Jewish identity, the Shema, the daily expression of faith for every Jew. Shema Yisrael, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Israel, listen. Our God is the Lord, only the Lord. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your being, and all your strength. In the language of appreciative inquiry, Jesus seized upon the best of the past as the way forward. No Jew can argue with that. Indeed, no Gentile convert can argue with it either. It is central. It is simple. But oh, it is not easy. Even with the addition of the verse from Leviticus, you will love your neighbor as yourself, we, as well as our forebears, have spilled enormous amounts of ink and blood over trying to get it just right, somehow believing that our neighbors might be as much in love with legalism as we are. Jesus, with the help of Deuteronomy and Leviticus, makes it very simple. But as I said, it's not easy. Because once we start to take seriously what it means to love God with all our heart, in other words, by showing our love for God with every decision we make, to love God with our very being, our very essence, and to love God with all that we have, that is our abundance, once we start to realize the implications of that love, and then add loving our neighbor with the same passion as we love ourselves, once we start to parse those out, we see how much easier it is to argue over theology or sexuality or liturgical practices. What must we do to be saved? Believe the right stuff? What's the greatest commandment? Which one of the 10? The 8th century prophets, precursors to Jesus, paved the way. What does the Lord require of you, we read in Micah, but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? Or in Amos, let justice roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Or in Hosea, for I desire steadfast love and not sacrifice, the knowledge of God rather than burnt offerings. Their prophecies were summed up in the passage we heard from Deuteronomy with Jesus' subsequent stamp of approval. Which commandment is the most important of all? Jesus replied, the most important one is, Israel, listen. Our God is the one Lord, and you must love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your being and with all your mind and with all your strength. The second is this, you will love your neighbor as yourself. No other commandment is greater than these. It's so simple, but it's so hard. Lord, have mercy on us all as we struggle to live out the great commandment, and help us extend our mercy and understanding to those who are also struggling. Amen. Amen. Please stand and let us continue our worship this morning using the Confession of Faith and the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. And
we look for the resurrection of the dead and life of the world to come. Amen.
In the prayers of the people in the bulletin, please respond to each bidding as shown in the bold print. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Episcopal Anglican province of Alexandria. In the Diocese of Colorado, we pray for all those who work with children and youth. In our church family, we pray for the outreach missions team as it meets this week. For your holy church, for those who have led the way,
we give thanks.
For those who will follow us,
we rejoice in hope.
For those who sit beside us, those whom we will never meet, who hunger for the riches of your grace, we pray for our leaders, for Michael, our presiding bishop, Kim, our bishop, Gary, our rector, and Nadine, our deacon.
Give them strength for today and for tomorrow.
We pray for wisdom for Joseph, our president, for Jared, our governor, for our legislators and courts. For those who hold earthly power throughout the world, give those who need courage to hold the space for justice and peace. We pray.
Give them strength for today and for tomorrow.
For all who suffer physical pain, and for those who take skilled, tender care of them, we pray for all, and for those we now name. Give them strength
for today and hope for tomorrow.
For those who face death today, may they join the throng of those before your throne who praise you, adored by angels and the throng of faithful people called your saints. And for those we now name. May we too sing your praises in harmony with those throughout the ages who have looked to you in hope and have seen your glory. Give us joy, we pray.
And give us strength for each day and each tomorrow.
We thank you, O God, for the saints of all ages, for those who in times of darkness kept the lamp of faith burning, for the great souls who saw visions of larger truths and dared to declare them, for the multitude of quiet and gracious souls whose presence has purified and sanctified the world, and for those known and loved by us who have passed from this earthly fellowship into the fuller life with you. Accept this, our thanksgiving, through Jesus Christ, our mediator and redeemer, to whom be praise and dominion forever. Amen.
Let us confess our sins to God. God of all mercy,
we confess that we have sinned against you, opposing your will in our hearts. We have denied your grace. in ourselves and in the world you have created. We repent of the evil that enslaves us, and the evil we have done, and the evil done in our hearts. Forgive, restore, and strengthen us through our Savior Jesus Christ, that we may abide in your love and serve only you. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Again, glad to see you all here, including those of you who are joining us remotely. Happy Halloween. We are today is not All Saints Sunday. The prayer book says you celebrate All Saints on All Saints Day or the Sunday following. On the other hand, we got to pay a little bit of attention to that, especially since the kids will be here this morning at the next service. So if you want to come back for Youth Sunday, I imagine some of them are going to be in costume. We'll have, of course, youth reading the lessons and preaching and leading the prayers and some music as well. So if you want to hang around for that, that would be great. Speaking of hanging around, at 9:15, we will have several of our delegates and folks who attended the last diocesan convention give sort of, I don't want to say a report, but, you know, why did they go? What did they hear? What did they learn? Why do they like to serve in this capacity on behalf of this congregation? So that will be at 9:15. It will be Zoomed. The link went out earlier this week because we have at least one person who was there who will be Zooming in and giving her response. So please do that if you find that useful. Next Sunday, Faith Forum, we will start a new series. Do you want to say anything about it, Nadine?
It's not so much theology, more about the spirituality of gratitude, which to me seemed like that. But I found some really interesting things that I think you might find interesting and enjoy. So
3 weeks on the spirituality of gratitude. At the end of those 3 weeks, we'll be in Advent. Whoa. Also, out in the entryway is a copy of a COVID update that came out from Bishop Kim on Friday. And so some people may have received it if they get the diocesan newsletter. If you didn't, there is a copy of it out there, and we will add the link to this coming week's e-news. So if you want to see what the current thoughts are from the Office of the Bishop and why we will continue and in some cases expand some of the practices that we have been doing, we're following the guidance from the Bishop's office. Are there birthdays or anniversaries to celebrate today? No. Then let us with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and labor unto the Lord.
Thank you.
All things come of thee, O Lord.
And of thine own have we given thee.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is truly right and good and joyful to give you thanks, all holy God, source of life and fountain of mercy. You have filled us and all creation with your blessing and fed us with your constant love. You have redeemed us in Jesus Christ and knit us into one body. Through your Spirit, you replenish us and call us to fullness of life. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels and with the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices in all creation as we sing. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of the universe and giver of life. You formed us in your own image and called us to dwell in your infinite love. You gave the world into our care that we might be your faithful stewards and show forth your bountiful grace. But we failed to honor your image in one another and in ourselves. We would not see your goodness in the world around us. And so we violated your creation, abused one another, and rejected your love. Yet you never ceased to care for us and prepared the way of salvation for all people. Through Abraham and Sarah, you called us into covenant with you. You delivered us from slavery, sustained us in the wilderness, and raised up prophets to renew your promise of salvation. Then in the fullness of time, you sent your eternal word, made mortal flesh in Jesus. Born into the human family and dwelling among us, he revealed your glory. Giving himself freely to death on the cross, he triumphed over evil, opening the way of freedom and life. On the night before he died for us, our Savior Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." The supper was ending. Jesus took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Remembering his death and resurrection, we now present to you from your creation this bread and this wine. By your Holy Spirit, may they be for us the body and blood of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grant that we who share these gifts may be filled with the Holy Spirit and live as Christ's body in the world. Bring us into the everlasting heritage of your daughters and sons, that with the ever-blessed Virgin Mary, blessed Saint Simon and Jude, and all your saints, past, present, and yet to come, we may praise your name forever. Through Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Hallelujah. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Hallelujah.
The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us pray. Loving God, we give you thanks for restoring us in your image and nourishing us with spiritual food in the sacrament of Christ's body and blood. Now send us forth a people forgiven, healed, renewed, that we may proclaim your love to the world and continue in the risen life of Christ our Savior.
Amen.
And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you this day and remain with you always.
Amen.
Thank you.
Spirit. Alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia. Thank you.